not understood correctly. I came into this laboratory in 1982. Those days I was in a BRC. We used to pipette 100 microliter using a glass pipette, and some people used to do it using mouth, and then came a small bulb, and then those days no fin pipettes were there. So then becomes a sophistication is you can keep it aside and use a tip and fin pipette and pipette. And then comes challenges of inaccuracies. And those days there was no auto analyzers. Everybody had to add one after another manually reagent, keep a timer, look at the timer, then read the what you call as photometry. Then came semi-auto analyzers, where you have to dilute and then put it to your machine. It will take a fixed quantum of microliter, then it will give out the values. That itself was a very great achievement. Then comes a fully automated analyzer, where you can load your samples, relax, that does what and all it needs to be done, and finally you look at a value. So it is a fully automated analyzer. Then in a laboratory, if there are 20 analyzers, 30 analyzers, then one can look for a track. And in India, first time a track came in the year 2009. And this was brought in by Siemens, and we had the floor investment of roughly around 12 crores. In that, you keep the specimen. There is a centralized software which knows the specimen has to go to which analyzer, which technology. Multiple technologies also can be hooked. Technically speaking, any brand also can be hooked, but then the guy who puts in the track wants his machine only to be hooked. So these are all a way of getting more business. One more automation level is pre-analytical as well as post-analytical, where it can centrifuge, it can decap, then it can put on the track, it goes for analysis. Analysis is over, it goes to a bay, and that bay, it is recapped, and it is reloaded on a tray, and the tray can be also sent directly to a cold room, which means it's an end-to-end automation, different levels of automation possible. And fortunately for me, in a single floor, I'm handling business in a large floor, so automation was, I won't say cost-effective, but justified. But having said that, each automation also has a limitation. When we purchased automation, we purchased for 20 crores, we thought the entire floor will be automated. But then only one-third of the machines it could accommodate. Then we understood we need to invest 60 crores if we want the complete floor to be automated. And in a 20%, 25% year-over-year growing company, you have to keep on investing 25 crores every year. So that's in fact very costly. I believe they couldn't go for similar automation in other places. Now they have come up with small automations, one photometry machine, one immunoassay machine, and that can connect, if necessary, one more hematology. Like that it has come. They are roughly around a crore or two. So on this subject we will be talking. Not that any of us are truly working on the floor, probably except the pathologist. We are all COOs, CFOs, and not truly are working in the floor. So more can come from you when the panel is open for discussion. And let me hear from each of you, what is your views about the quality improvements or cost aspects or speed aspects? You can start from Sujata. It is working, I believe.
Morning audience. Very warm welcome once again. And glad to be a part of this discussion today. As sir rightly put, the levels of automation have progressed, over the years. Nowadays, it's very common for those of you who work in laboratories to find auto analyzers, as we call them, which means the biochemistry tests, the immunoassays, the hematology tests, etc., are done on automated analyzers. But that's not all about automation. I think over the last few years, a lot of other processes which are repetitive, which are manual, have been automated in the pre-analytical as well as the post-analytical phase. And the advantage definitely is, one is, the reduction in the personnel cost, if I talk from a finance perspective, because you're trying to move away from tasks which do not require expertise. Something like opening a cap and recapping a tube does not require expertise. These are repetitive manual tasks. So having automated these tasks definitely leads to a reduction in the personnel cost overall. And any process which is automated gives you the operational efficiency as well as the quality that you would probably find in, say, manufacturing units, which is the whole concept of why this automation has started growing up. This also has the advantage that the technicians who are skilled into certain sort of expertise, they can save their time to get into more expertise-oriented tasks rather than the manual repetitive tasks. So that's definitely an advantage. So quality and efficiency. Reduction in number of errors, because any task which is automated compared to a manual will definitely lead to a reduction in the number of overall errors. And turnaround time, which is very important for, I think, most of the laboratories today, giving out the right results at the right time, in the shortest possible time. So automating these tasks definitely helps reduction in the overall turnaround time. So there are definite advantages. Cost justification is one of the key challenges which we all struggle with when we look at total lab automation, as we call it. So automating the entire range of testing from pre-analytical to post-analytical is what is called as total lab automation nowadays. And the cost justification will obviously depend on, what the goal an organization is seeking or a laboratory is seeking. And there are options today available. I may choose a particular task in my lab. If I do not justify having a total lab automation in my lab, I may choose to automate only a certain manual task, which will give me the goals that I'm looking for. So these are some of the areas that we could, further elaborate and talk about.
So what makes you to limit automation in your organization?
First of all, good morning, everyone. A warm welcome. And it's really a privilege to be among eminent doctors and scientists, especially being a CFO. I think, it gives me that honor. Doctor, to answer that question, the limitations in automation, first of all, cost, as I think Dr. Sujata also mentioned, cost is a significant factor in limiting, because automation does not come cheap. It's an expensive affair. Even if one looks at automation and would want to invest, you need to get buy-in from the investors or the promoters, even the staff, because there's a human tendency to resist for any automation.
Cost is a problem or volume is a problem?
It's actually both, because cost and volume go hand in hand. So, if you don't have volumes, the cost don't justify. So I think it cuts both ways.
It's the volume.
Yes.
I think anyone who has volume can very easily go for automation. Otherwise, automation will be standing. And I want all of you to understand, any machine standing in a laboratory is a liability. And any machine running in the laboratory is an asset.
Yes.
So I think volume is where probably the limit is. Yeah. Go ahead.
Further, I think automation has been evolving at warp speeds. Technology which was 3 years ago, 3 months ago, keeps on changing rapidly. So one needs to also be cognizant of the fact that the automation is relevant. It's relevant because the benefits of automation accrue over a period of time. You don't get to see instant results. So I think one needs to be cognizant of the fact, when you are deploying technology which will automate your processes. As Dr. Sujata said, it automates most of the repetitive tasks. So, your employees, your technicians get to focus on areas where they need to focus to. But I think in terms of overall, if one had to look at the decision making of choosing an automation, the volumes, the cost, the technology options, I think those are the limiting factors one needs to consider.
Right. Actually, the volume is the one which actually drives. Before getting into track automation, had roughly around 10,000 specimen a day, which is working out to be 50,000 investigations a day. When I ask boys to do manually decap and recap, MSc boys used to ask me directly a question. Sir, ye bandar ka kaam karne ke liye thodi maine MSc padh ke idhar aaya. Because it is bandar ka kaam. It's a simple, straightforward. There doesn't need MSc's, BSc's, PhD's for doing it. So that made me to think and invest money. And volume is playing a big role in deciding how much automation and how much you can spend on it. So I believe that laboratories who have volume has no choice, because you are fatigued. Your samples, which is reported, which is not reported, where is the sample? It's a big challenge. Automations give complete solution. Only thing is, it needs volumes. Let me hear from Dr. Gaur.
Good morning, everybody. You know, when I think of automation, it reminds me of a movie when I saw in my college time. That was a Charlie Chaplin's movie. I don't know, many of you must have seen that movie. Because Charlie Chaplin was a lazy guy. He just wanted to sit on a bed in kind of a mass, like relaxing chair. He wanted everything to be like, okay, this button, tea comes. This button, the toothbrush comes. No, I mean, everything to be done in my bed, nothing more than that. So probably, you know, at the end of the movie, probably how it ends is probably one of the button fails and he's keep brushing his teeth and all the teeth are out. I think that's probably the concept thought in my mind the automation is. But of course, since that time we evolved, these are probably one of the rare risks now, and no more such risks are there. Things have evolved. When it comes to pathology practice, I think we have three components. What Velumani is already expert in that. He said that pre-analytical, analytical, and the post-analytical part now. Analytical has been, automation has been processed for a long. I think somewhere in 1989, Dr. Mochi in Japan actually have set up the whole concept where he integrated a couple of automated instruments with multiple the local conveyor belts here and there and demonstrated to the people like how this can be done. But after that, a lot of automations happened in the instrument when it comes to the hematology or histopathology, biochemistry, immunology, molecular biology, where instruments have been very, very fine. Now, in fact, they probably, they can keep repeating the process, the precision, the result reproduction is perfect and quality-driven kind of thing. And now the improvement is happening in the analytical space is the throughput, speed and speed and speed. The major automation changes are happening actually in the pre-analytical space. And that's where I think, all of you aware, probably he's also mentioned, Velumani is for the country. The first center we have, he established the conveyor belt or the robotic arms, what we call as...
Track-driven.
Tracks, actually, probably. So that's all of you understand from pathology point of view, about 65 to 70% of errors which happen in pathology diagnostics are pre-analytical errors. So if you can automate that process, you can eliminate the manual intervention. Because the same guy doing same job morning, every 1 hour is bound to create an error. But if you have an automation, those things are very well defined. You can, the alerts are already there. You have somebody monitoring on the screens and the monitors, and you can always capture the alerts, and you can immediately do whatever you require. So in the pre-analytical parts, right from barcoding, the sample centrifuging, after that, identification of right sample, the clots are there and do not, followed by, you can say it moves into
analysis.
What quality controls should be run or not, whether, because depending on the sample load, if I have 500 samples, every 500 control has to be run. All this can be very well defined in the system. Right temperature sense, the sample has come to you or not, or the right type of sample, the capping, of the sample, decapping of the sample, adequating of samples now, especially the molecular biology. where the sample amount is very, very precious, and we have to use some almost like the tune of about, you know, 10 microliters or even less, much lesser than that. So manual pipetting to from there to auto allocating. That's something sample of allocated, written well. These are all has now come into practice. And it's really doing good results. But the challenge, and it helps you because I run an Onquest laboratory. We have a high-end molecular oncology, maybe the importance of sample. One sample which has come to me, say especially for RNA studies or some bone marrow which has come to me or something else has come to me, which or biopsy or tissue, even something which has come to us, it cannot because tumor is already gone now. How do you get a repeat sample? Blood sample, you might get a repeat sample. So that's where I think automation is playing a very important role. And we can get away with the unskilled or semi-skilled manpower or something where we can do repetitive acts are done to be better. The sample transportation, what you said.
Do you think
from the pneumatic ducts, in fact, now a couple of people are using now, many hospitals are now using pneumatic ducts, and in fact, I haven't seen yet, but the robots carrying the samples to the various part of the lab. That way, I think pre-analytical plays a very important role. And lastly, the post-analytical part. In the post-analytical thing, we probably feel reports authenticated and it's gone. That's not properly. Inventory, the storage, the sample, right temp, 7 days normally as per the SOP, we're supposed to store the sample store, and retrieval of sample after that's never required. Sometime you require to do a sample in dilution. The report is done, the sample is stacked on one side, you have a the sample to be repeated, and when the pathologist sees or biochemistry person sees, okay, something more to be done, it retrieve again and automated. I think that completes the automation, and that's where the bigger companies expense, of course, the finance guys will speak on it. Quality is no doubt questionable. I mean, cannot be questioned on automation, and probably that's the era we're looking forward to automation.
Does it lead to people losing jobs? Does automation lead to people losing jobs? Yes? Not really. When we brought in automation, all my employees' faces were very small, thinking that abhi mera kya hoga. But then today we have more manpower requirement than pre-automated, without automation. With all said and done, all automations fail thrice in a month. So they are most important on those 2-3 days. So automation hasn't truly reduced the manpower requirement. Probably they can do better jobs, and you don't need more people. Your view, sir.
Yeah. So I being a CFO, I will say my this perspective on the automation. First, just let me tell you on how the day starts. The day starts at 9:15. By chance, the stock market opened at 9:15. We open the stock market, see the price, and being into the diagnostic space, looks into the peers which are being listed. Thyrocare and Dr. Lal's, these are the two peer listed. We go there, see the price, 9:45, get a call from our owners, promoters. Saurabh, please come over. They are being asked to show that because they are being listed peers, their financials are available in the stock market. So there we see the complete P&L details, where on one extreme is the Thyrocare with around 400 crore annual this turnover, getting the margin of around 40% plus. In between, there is a Lal PathLab, 1,000 crore plus turnover, having a margin of, say, 26%. And on one side is an SRL, having, again, 1,100 crore annual turnover with a margin of 18%. So there's a huge, huge disparity. Then being asked to analyze it. The main analysis comes out of that is, for example, Thyrocare, as this sir has rightly put it, he works on a single floor. Single floor, SRL works, SRL is having 220 labs all across India. So there is, of course, a benefit goes across there. Now the question comes in, if we at SRL make it automated everything, what do we do with the manpower? As he has rightly said, if I have to automate everything, it means that I have to have a centralized labs. It means I have to cut maybe 2,000 man force, which is easier said than done. Neither we want to do that, neither our this conscience allow us to do that. So this is a very difficult dichotomy between these two scenarios, what to do, what not to do. So having said that, and then being a CFO, if someone comes to me with an automation, my first question is that, now I'm sitting on the other side. What is the manpower reduction across there? What is the payback there? What is the ROI there? If say the payback is coming, say for 6 years, it is not worth it. So there are so many issues. It's not as simple to automate, not to automate. But having said everything, the way to go is to automate. That is the way the industry is just growing. Sooner or later, everybody has to automate. This is my...
Add on. I think, you know, we firstly are sort of very, very well said from the finance angle, because when I also look from the operation angle, my promoters always ask me, oh, what is an ROI? What it is? I think, like, that's fine. That's important. We can't get away with the manpower. It's very difficult to take out manpower from the team which is existing. But yes, I think when it comes to gradually the skill, actually, the high technology driven, when it's the fine sample driven, probably you have to invest into automation. Yes. Secondly, part of the volume driven, because you don't have, probably we have, I also have about 40 labs, and we work at different centers. Centralized labs definitely works much better, because that will be better ROI, better returns, faster reports when the TAT is driven. But in the long term, I think, not even long term, probably another 5 years, we need to invest into automation of some nature, because currently it's a very, very heavy conveyor, tracks are there, but nothing, smaller versions coming up. The labs have to go, starting from the high technology to the basic technology right there. That's probably going. And then, remember, I think, Saurabh, I'll say the finance angle. I am talking from a purely pathologist point of view. Whenever the lab space is allotted to the pathologist or something, they always, and we give the maximum diagnosis. But only thing is, if you look at the priorities given by the hospital to the diagnostic labs, I'd probably they give it a lower priority. That's, you have a different angle from the finance. I am from the pathologist angle I'm talking about. Operation guys have a different thought process.
Right. So automation is a very wide, vague word. It covers, as I said, from probe movement to centrifugation, decapping, recapping. A lot of things are happening. Unfortunately, for the manufacturer, there is another challenge. What is the optimum size to make? When we established the track, which was around 96 meters, main soch sata ka mera hi duniya mein sabse lamba hai. Then I understood in Japan, there is a laboratory with 5 times larger track. Imagine Japan is only less than 10 crore population and 5 times larger. Another laboratory in Brazil has 20 times longer. So big manufacturers have a challenge of attending to 1,000,000 tests a day to 1,000 tests a day, all are laboratories. So they have challenges. Having said that, all big players are coming with small solutions, because otherwise they won't be able to sell in India. I think today, for various purposes, we can archive samples. There is an automation available. I think Abbott, Roche, Siemens, Beckman, they have got to your fantasy, whatever you want. I think they unfortunately have bigger sizes. They don't have smaller sizes. And some of them have come up with the smaller sizes. And I'm pretty sure in the long run, the size of automation will become smaller, cheaper, and that only can make affordable. The size of the laboratories will never become uniform, because as a pyramid says, you have to have a laboratory with 500 samples a day, and you will also have a laboratory which has 5 lakh samples a day. Having said that, let me hear from the panelists, what is their dream when it comes to automation?
So having heard from the finance and from the operations, and we've talked about how automation benefits laboratories, as laboratories want to grow bigger, handle more sample volumes, because as Sir said, that's the only way to handle larger and larger sample volumes. you cannot do all the tasks that a laboratory does if you still continue to have your processes performed manually. Of course, every pathologist dreams to automate the task, but when we look at a total lab automation, I think a few considerations which all of us should think about before we even plan. So one, as sir also pointed out, the space constraints. You know, total lab automation actually works best when you start off in a new space. And when you're starting off in a new space, I think the investment is very hard to justify, especially to the finance. Because a lot of benefits that we talked about in the earlier part of the discussion with regards to bringing in more efficiency, reduction in the number of errors, improving turnaround times, actually does not have a tangible direct financial impact. I think a direct financial impact comes from manpower reduction, as we spoke about. So this is something all of us should consider when we plan our dream laboratory, space constraints, especially in our country. Second is, you know, with the technology rapidly advancing, for example, there's a lot of work happening in microfluidics, nanotechnology, etc. Even today, pediatric samples, we prefer to collect in small microtainers. And if you're looking at a standard automated system which is used to handling adult samples, what are we going to do for the pediatric samples? Or as a dream, whether there is a possibility of creating an automated system which can significantly reduce the amount of sample that you need to collect even for adults. So that level of automation is also possible. And I think the bigger we dream, the better it is for us to achieve the dream laboratory that we all think of.
CFO, what is your dream? They should not ask for money.
Well said, yeah. I think from a dream that CFOs have for automation, I'll start with a maxim that used to be there many years ago. The income tax department used to always thrust upon automation, but that department never made money. It was the technology companies who made money by selling technology as well as saving taxes. But today, if you see, even the income tax department has automated. You know, you get your refunds within a couple of days, you get notices also in a couple of days. So it has evolved, and likewise, I think automation, what from a CFO's perspective, would be where the data that you get through, it's all automated. I think today, bi-directional systems, you know, they allow you to track, or the systems are both traceable and trackable. You can track the specimen right from, at the patient registration to the results, which eventually, you have an audit trail and helps the auditors, the investors, to do more of data analysis. So I think those are the things which I would, in terms of look at from a CFO perspective. And at the same time, the biggest challenge for us is the ROI. I think every CFO has to justify the ROI to the investors, to the board, or even to the promoters when there's an automation involved.
I think you are a very intelligent CFO who says hardware should not be automated, software should be completely automated because it doesn't need too much cost. I will get everything in hand. When you get into hardware automation, the vendors are involved and a lot of money is involved, right? Perfectly, all right. Your dream.
See, there's one more. We have one more factor across there. If you automate, it helps in this reducing TAT accuracy, which indirectly results in increase in volumes. Volumes mean business. Business means ROI. So indirectly, it do help. In making it happen.
Yeah, when the volume grows, justified. Yeah. But then egg first or chicken first is always another question. Now we don't have volume. Once we get volume, then we will invest. Then, volumes don't that easily come if you have not adequately invested.
It has to be a different approach in the reference lab, which are the larger labs. I think certainly the company should automate. In the satellite labs, which are the feeder labs, automation may not suffice unless the volume is there.
Yes, sir. Your dream in automation.
I think definitely that's a volume-based game, what rightly said. But, gradually the way the diagnostic is increasing, gradually the way the demand of the quality is improving, the way the TAT is improving. Now, in fact, I still remember some about 2020, in fact, when Dr. Velumani is probably not even started. We just started, I think, thyroid. The thyroid was somewhere 83, 84. At that time, the reporting TAT was 2 days or 3 period.
Oh, sometimes it is one full month. In government organizations, they will buy one kit and will do the test only once in a month.
So I think that is not, demand is like, I want report right now. If you look at the shift in the diagnostics, what's really happening is patient from the walking to lab, they want to like from point of care, dear patient, it's immediate rapid testing is now demand. So this automation definitely helps you because cutting down a lot of time and the lean period in between. And it definitely helps your technician staff. One technician can do the multiple work at one time. So I think, yes, volumes will go up, quality will go up. Errors with the consumer forum coming up, the medical errors are now coming up. How many times you can always go back? Your question probably once would cost you about, if you lose a case, you're ending up almost paying 15, 20, 30 lakh rupees for the report. I think all these factors have to be played in. And now analyze, the better TAT, better quality, less errors, and companies like Abbott, Siemens, Roche, and McCoulter, they're all coming out the smaller version of automation for the smaller labs, reduce probably lesser infrastructure, less space, all this have to happen. It's evolving, but we just can't take an eye off from automation. I think I'll probably still again say for the finance side, give us little more, we'll give you much more. I think that's it.
So the patient is impatient. So that is where we are having challenges. And my dream about automation, I think it's not a small dream, it's a big dream. Why should we have 7 analyzers standing in the laboratory and every sample has to go to all different analyzers one by one? What is there in an analyzer? Why the analyzer has to look so big? This iPhone today is completely solving so much of our challenges. So should be an analyzer. It should do thyroid also. It should do cholesterol also. It should do CBC also. It should do a HbA1c also. What is the challenge? Why you keep 4 different machines and then try to put a track to connect it? Why not you integrate all these machines and put it in a single piece where you just load one specimen somewhere, result comes out, and it is affordable for even a laboratory at a remote town? This is fantasy. When I talk to manufacturers, they say, "Fir hamara dhanda pura band ho jayega." But then you will sell more, it will have more reception. So I have a reason to believe one day by 2030, not too far, because all 8 billion brains are working in this world. It is likely that in another 10 years' time, you will have a single gadget which will do all biochemistry. And of course, in radiology, we didn't talk at all. In radiology, there should be one machine in which you lie down. It should do ultrasound. It should do CT. It should do MRI. It should do PET-CT. It should do X-ray also. That's the dream. There is nothing wrong in dreaming. But these two things are likely to come. I think Dr. Neelesa is sitting and smiling, whether truly that is around or if it comes, what happens to the radiology industry. It should get simplified and it should become easy to operate. So that is where dreams are. And is that, in a quick answer from any of you, is that you expect something artificial intelligence should do to the laboratory business? Just 1 minute each.
So yes, definitely, artificial intelligence can play a very, very big role. There are already some companies and manufacturers that are working on AI solutions. And fortunately, as a pathologist, I can proudly say that pathologists actually are at the forefront of adopting new technologies always. The way AI can help a pathology lab or even a pathology diagnosis is a lot of testing, especially with regards to chemistry, immunoassays, etc., can be automated to an algorithm-based testing, where you do a test and it is automatically reflects to another test. Though reflex testing is even currently available. To give you an example of how AI could probably help is, a lot of work is happening in digital pathology. Where we have whole image, whole slide imaging, which is recently approved by FDA. Also, you put a slide under the microscope, computer images of the slides are captured automatically by an auto scanner. The slides are stored in a computer. They could be stacked, they could be stitched, etc. And a pathologist could be sitting anywhere in the world and easily report.
But
going one step further, what could happen is there are companies that are working on automated image analysis, where these images are built into an artificial intelligence solution, so that a probable diagnosis on that slide could already be available to the pathologist even before he or she reviews the slide. So that is one aspect. There are other chemistry-based algorithms, especially for cardiovascular risk, diabetes risk, that could be built in, which will definitely go a long way in...
No, algorithms may not be truly called as artificial intelligence, but certainly looking at a slide and telling this is pancreatic cancer, this is prostate cancer,
yes,
that could be great value to the industry. But at the same time, pathologists will start feeling, abhi mera kya rahega?
I wouldn't say that really, because reporting a slide on a digital image takes an amount of expertise and training, because we pathologists are trained to traditionally report looking at the microscopic slides. And though the same slide image is captured on the computer, but giving out a primary diagnosis by looking at a computer image is a totally different field and area of expertise.
Right. In case of CBC, I'm pretty sure 90% of the CBCs are auto-reported. Only 10% of them go for a peripheral blood smear. So
yes,
similar thing could happen in
even
histopathology.
Even peripheral blood
also
smear could be automated. If you look at malaria, for example, and if you can, you know, build an AI solution for it, it could give a probable diagnosis of the presence or absence of malaria, say, on a smear.
Right. Thank you very much. When the MC comes to the stage, it says that, gentlemen, time is over. And thank you very much for the panelists for being wonderful on the stage, and audience for having a patient hearing on our whatever views we could make on it, take on it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.